It's Julian Assange and WikiLeaks that have returned honor to journalism. Julian is a truth teller, and that's what has upset those who continue what Goebbels called the big lie.
That was John Pilger at the very top, and of course Anton Karas and the third man. I'm Randy Credico. Randy Credico live on the fly. Assange countdown to freedom. Today we're going to play later on in the show, the second two thirds. We're going to play our initial interview with Julian Assange, which took place exactly 6 years ago, more or less. And so I thought you might want to listen to that and see who it is that is being tortured, who has been renditioned, who has been kidnapped, and has been tormented and has been abused and persecuted. I get excited. Gabriel Shipton, I'm a little sick today, a little worn down, I look at that, I look at your brother there, and it gets to me. Every time I look at that video, it gets to me. You, your father, his father, and just about Stella, his children. And so I don't even know where to start today. I've been down in DC for the last 11 weeks. And every time I think that I got problems, I look at those photos and say, I don't have any problems. And that's what inspires me to keep moving, you know, and I know it inspires other people, including yourself. I'm probably going to edit that part out, what you just heard. But Gabriel, thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Randy. Thank you for your tireless activism, and I think your contribution to spreading awareness and making my brother's taking up my brother's cause, it's unmatched, and on behalf of me and my family. Thank you very much for everything that you do.
Yeah, I don't know about that, but thank you for the kind words. But the problem is, Gabriel, is that you know what a battle this is, the forces that we are fighting against. This is an easy case on the face of it. This is an easy case. A man should be, there should be statues of him all over this country and all over Europe, all over Fleet Street, or whatever Fleet Street is today. And yet, UK and the US has demonized him. They've dragged him through the mud. They've destroyed 12 years of his life, the best years of his life. And it's so frustrating. And it gets to the point where, are we just going to throw in the towel and say, all right, we lose this battle? Or we have to keep moving on. That's, there are times where I say, all right, I can't, I think that's what they want you to think.
Yeah.
They want you to say, all right, throw in the towel, go somewhere else.
Yep. And I think, Randy, this is a worldwide movement that I see as something that is growing. Essentially people, most people are good people, and when you inform them about this case and you inform them exactly what's going on, Julian's persecution and why it's happening, to be him being made an example of so that you know, that that these powerful people can continue to, you know, commit war crimes, can continue to commit torture. I think normal people, good people, which there are many of, most people, they come to our side, and we've seen that, you know, as we fight this fight all around the world. You know, last week Julian was nominated for the Sakharov Prize, and he was shortlisted, you know, one of three people. The Sakharov Prize is the most important human rights, freedom of expression prize given by the European Parliament. So you have this situation where the European Parliament is acknowledging Julian's work, acknowledging, you know, the publishing of the Afghan war files, the Iraq war logs, and the diplomatic cable set, you know, which brought the end of the Iraq war, acknowledging that as a great contribution to global human rights, to freedom of expression. And so you have this situation where you have the European Parliament acknowledging this work, and then on the other side of the pond there in the UK, Julian is sitting in a prison cell for the exact same work that the European Parliament is awarding him for. So I think the sort of lines have been drawn in this fight, and good good principled people are coming onto our side more and more.
It's a tough road to hoe, but you're right. I mean, more people, I look at 4 or 5 years ago where we were and where we are today, it certainly has increased, you know, I don't know, manifold, I don't know, tenfold or twelvefold, but definitely manifold numbers. You're responsible in large part of the shift across Europe and Australia with this award-winning documentary called Ithaca, which you've probably seen it 100 times already, because I know you've been at every single opening, and I've seen openings for the last 8 months. So tell me how that is going, and what's the response been, and what's on the horizon with it?
Ithaca is a it's a sort of different look at you know, what's happening to Julian. It's a behind the scenes look at the people who are closest to Julian and who are at the center of this fight against the descent into barbarity of these Western democracies that we're seeing. And that's John Shipton, Julian's dad, and Stella Morris, Julian's wife. So we follow their journey, and it's their personal story about, I guess, you know, this problem, this you know, what we were talking about. How do we keep going, you know, when we're fighting the largest adversary on the planet, you know, the global hegemon? You know, how do we keep going? And I think John, Stella, you know, people like you set this amazing example of, you know, how activism and just resilience and you know, courage in the face of adversity can change the world. And so that's what the film's about. We've done over 60 screenings, you know, in the US, in Australia, the UK, in Mexico, and now we're having our North American premiere, which will be on the 13th of November at the SVA Theatre in Chelsea at 7:45 as part of the Doc NYC Documentary Festival. So yeah, we're bringing it to American audiences now, and very interested to see the reactions of American audiences. Usually people are very moved, very touched, and inspired. You know, they come out thinking, you know, what can I do? I want to join this movement. You know, everyone at the end asks a constant question whenever we do this. Is how can we help? What can we do? And that's, you know, I think that's the greatest thing that's come from this film.
Well, now it's playing in Chelsea, and do you have an itinerary after that? Or are you kind of like rolling the dice in the U.S. and hoping that it rolls around in different parts of the country?
Yeah, so we're premiering it at the Chelsea, as you said, and then next year, early next year, John and I, we want to come over and do a US-wide tour with the film, and really just take it on the road, and you know, take it to audiences. You know, we've found you know, this is a political film. You know, it's a personal journey, but it's also a political film, and political documentaries, particularly about cases like Julian's or persecutions like Julian's, you know, we face all these hurdles, you know, all these gatekeepers within the, you know, say like the Netflix or the Amazon, these sort of gatekeepers who don't let you into their distribution network. So we really have to bring it to the people. And that's why we're planning a US-wide tour with the film early next year. It really opens the eyes of people to what's actually at stake here and, you know, what's happening to Julian. Now, you know, if you expose the crimes of the most powerful state on earth, if you expose the crimes of Washington, you have no rights. And, you know, once people sit down and they see this and they see John and Stella fighting to free Julian, it really touches them but also informs them about what's really going on. We are nominated for, you know, Best Documentary at the Australian Academy and Television Awards, and also for a Walkley Award. So 11 years ago, Julian won a Walkley for his contribution to journalism, and Walkley is like the Pulitzer Prize of Australia, right? And so 11 years later, this film Ithaca, about those people trying to free Julian, for his work that he won an Walkley Award for, is nominated for a Walkley Award too.
So irony in that, I guess, right?
Yes.
Wow, that's amazing. So let's talk about Julian. Have you seen your brother recently?
Yes, I was at the, I went to Belmarsh to see him today. I went with my dad, John. You know, I think we had an hour and a half or so visit with Julian. Just updating him on, you know, because we've just been in Germany, in Berlin with the film as well, where we won the audience award at the Berlin Human Rights Film Festival. So
fantastic.
I could tell him about that and all the things that are happening in, you know, Germany's quite strong for Julian. The population there are all very supportive of him. You know, a lot of the WikiLeaks infrastructure and back office is sort of German in a way. So he has a very, you know, strong support group there, particularly in the German Bundestag as well. We did a photo opportunity with Bundestag parliamentarians on the steps of the Reichstag a couple of days ago, and it was 30 plus parliamentarians from every major party in Germany. So telling him about that. And just, you know, telling him about all the different people that we meet that tell him to stay strong and stay
alive.
What
was his response to all that? I mean, you know, 4 years worth, you know, it's like, all right, I'm still here 4 years later. You and your father are leaving and he's still there. How does he respond to all of that? Is he still optimistic, or is there a sense of resignation at this point in time? I mean, I hate to ask you those questions, but, you know, for me, I would be resigned to it for 4 years, but I know he's a man of great resilience.
Yeah, I mean, it's incredible. Like, every time I go there, I can't believe that he still has this fighting flame, you know, that keeps burning inside him. You know, he's just, we're expecting the response from the US on his appeal on the 31st of October, and then expecting another high court hearing, whether his application to appeal will go ahead or not. So, you know, Julian is, I'm always blown away by his resilience, his courage, and his ability to keep fighting no matter what.
He's hands-on on this legal part, right?
And there's nobody who knows his case better than him. So, he's definitely part of this, part of his, he's an integral part of his defense team. And that fight, I think, also is part of what keeps him going inside. He's really putting all his energy into this fight. And it's not just about him either. Sure, it saves his life if he's released and the extradition is rejected. But Julian fights for all of us, for all of our rights, our democratic rights, our right to know.
Absolutely no bigger case right now, because it includes everything. It's all here. If you had to pick one fight, this is the fight because it includes all of the fights. This is the one. If you had to pick one battle, is it this? Is it that? This is the one that includes all things. If I got one fight left to me, I got to focus on the one that has the most good for the human race. And this one does. The consequences are so bad if we lose this one. I think people really have to dig in and get to know that and then get involved. Let's get back to your film. Is there anything else you could tip them off to where they're able to see excerpt here and there?
Well, they can follow us on Twitter at Ithaca Movie or visit the website, which is ithaca.movie. And that has a lot of information of where you can watch it, where it's showing, what time, etc. Also on Facebook, Ithaca Movie, on all the social medias.
It's a great movie. I know you produce it, and Ben Lawrence is a director who I met in New York. What a great guy he is. You couldn't have a finer, talented guy than Ben Lawrence, and I congratulate him for his fine work. And in closing here, because we're going to play this full interview with your brother, I want people to see. I want them to hear. What is missing out there? What is missing out there that we have been robbed of for the last, since Bill Morris, or a year before when Moreno cut him off, for the last nearly 5 years? I want people to see and hear what has been missing out there and why we are the worst for it. What can you tell people out there, Gabriel? What is your recommendation? What is your advice to people who want to get involved? What can they do? People that, there's only so many things that people can do, right? They're congressmen, they can send money in. I mean, what do you, people feel helpless. I feel helpless sometimes. And, what is your advice?
I think, we just have to keep fighting, and part of that is arming yourself with good information, talking to your friends. That's the most important thing. I think these things are born, movements are born over a coffee, over a beer, over a glass of wine or a cup of tea, where it's one or two or three people getting together and finding out the truth together. I think that's the most important thing that people can do is, talk to their friends and family, talk to their neighbors, keep spreading the word about this. Because once people find out what's really going on, they join us. They can see this this persecution for what it is. So that's what I think that's the simplest thing that people can do is just keep talking, arm yourself with the good information, and go to talk to your friends, family, neighbors, call your congresspeople, make appointments to go and see them. Those are two very important things as well.
Okay, Gabriel Shifton, I want to say thank you for being on the show. Thank you for all the time you've afforded this program. And please come visit me when you're in New York. I like to show you around where the
I'd love to.
Deer and the antelope play. Okay. Seldom is here. Seldom, whatever the. I'm such a clown. I just got back from the ER. Seldom is heard. Not a discouraging word. All right, you know that song. All right, upstate. You got to come up, you and your pop. All right.
Yep.
I'm Randy Credico. This has been Randy Credico live on the fly. Assange Countdown to Freedom. Kelly Lane, who is in North Carolina, is the engineer and the editor. And we're going to go from here. You're going to hear a little bit of music, and then we're going back to 2016 and an interview with the greatest publisher of our lifetime, Julian Assange.
Yeah, thanks, Randy. Bye.
Same old thing, and I wish that you would.
All right. I got to read this this statement. I just got an text message from my good buddy Cornell West, who I was arrested with and spent a day in jail. I got some pictures of us in jail together. They didn't take my camera, but it says, "Please tell Brother Assange I send my love and respect for his courage and determination. I shall never forget our interview in the embassy in London. He will be free soon." He's talking about Julian Assange, and we, I hope, have him on the phone right now. Julian, are you there? Hello? You got it? We got him here? How's that? Just there's always little technical problems here at WBAI. Okay. We got you there, Julian. I can hear him a little bit. I don't know if you can hear him. Listen, it's okay. Just bear with us. So we have Julian Assange from London, from the Ecuadorian embassy, and we are very happy and pleased and honored that he is here at WBAI. Julian is a... Okay. All right. Can you hear us now, Julian?
Yes.
Okay, I'm sorry. These things happen here at WBI. We've been around independent radio. You've been on the station many times, mostly on Democracy Now!, and you were at the studio on 120 Wall Street like 20 years ago, somebody told me, 15, 20 years ago. So
It was about 6 or 7 years ago. It feels like 20.
Does it? It's 6 or 7 years ago, 120 Wall Street. Well, they've moved around since then. Now they're in Brooklyn on Atlantic Avenue. We wish you were in the room with us at this point. And I just want to thank you. So many people are listening. They know that you're on the phone. Now, I am not Mike Wallace. I'm not like one of those hardcore. I'm not an interrogator here. Some people are going to think this is an infomercial for WikiLeaks and for Julian Assange. But, you know, this is a progressive radio station, and I must tell you that everybody here is thrilled that you're on, and we all consider you to be a hero, which you are, and we thank you. We thank you for the great work that you've done throughout your life on behalf of spreading information out there. You've been a beacon of truth. You've been a messenger of truth, and we apologize that our government has been hounding you for so long.
Well, I don't know what you can say about that, but I'm struck by this philosophical position of I am not Mike Wallace.
Well, I'm not Mike Wallace. Do you remember Mike Wallace?
Quite a thing for everyone but Mike Wallace to say.
Yes, but, you know, Mike Wallace would put you in, they're all interrogators. I'm watching you, even a comedian who I started out with, Bill Maher. You know, I wasn't comfortable watching you on that show with Bill Maher. I think he was a little tough on you.
Well, it was definitely good fun. I don't mind interrogations, actually. I think there are times that type of approach is called for. For example, when you're dealing with very slimy politicians that are extremely skilled at dodging questions.
But right, no, I agree.
My experience, my don't remember the name, rather limited experience, but experience at interviewing people.
I think it's
actually more interesting to kind of
how that's gone.
Give them enough rope.
Right.
To kind of hear their arguments at what they feel is their best. And then you can contrast with someone else.
Right, I see. Yes, well, we'd like for you to be here at the station when you get out of London and have your own show here, and you can do that with politicians. Didn't you once run for, you were going to run for office in Australia for Senate?
I did. I found something quite unusual, which is that in Australia, if you can submit a postal vote, then you are also entitled to run for election, provided you haven't been convicted of a serious crime, which I haven't. So, and there is some unusual, there's an old precedent of a governor in the UK running in the 1900s in Australia. So, yeah, we tried to do that. Didn't think there was much chance, but I thought we'd draw some attention.
Well, I think it's a good idea. You know, I ran for Senate here against Chuck Schumer,
yeah,
who makes Hillary Clinton look like a progressive. I mean, he may be the next leader of the Senate, and I know he's no fan of yours, and I don't think...
I ran for the Senate as well. That was the Australian Senate.
Yeah, well, 2010, again, I ran against Schumer, and he had me thrown off the ballot. But, you know, I was doing it as performance art. Were you doing it as performance art, or were you... seriously trying
not
to...
Not as performance art, a bit too... Because, you know, during election period, as you get closer to the election, all the other issues close over, and it's just what the two major parties are talking about. So in order to kind of...
That's what I meant, though. I mean, you're basically trying to shine some light on the two-party system. You didn't run as in one of the two major parties. You ran as an independent, is that it?
We ran with the WikiLeaks party. We created a party basically just because on the voting forms, if it's a party, you appear high up in the voting form. If it's individual, you don't.
I see.
Of like buried among 67 others.
And did you? You didn't hit the road campaigning with posters and bunting and all of that.
Like there was a team of people in Australia of volunteers, and I got about 150,000 votes.
Wow.
In the state that I was in.
That's amazing. I got 29,000 in New York State, so you did a lot better than I did. But I ran against Governor Cuomo in 2014. But, you know, I was totally hammered by the press. If they did any coverage at all, New York Times didn't do a thing on me in 2014. They basically helped out Andrew Cuomo, as they have with Hillary Clinton, as they have with Chuck Schumer. And sitting in that room there, looking at this election in the United States, what is your overview of this election in the United States? If I may just get away from...
Well, in some ways, it's super interesting. In other ways, it's fairly boring. You've got two candidates deeply disliked by both the population, by both groups of population. Hillary Clinton, who's kind of a predictable, boring liberal war hawk. Although I think probably now you have to question whether she's a liberal war hawk, because she's brought all the neocons onto her side as well.
She's close to Henry Kissinger, you know.
Well, it's much worse than that. She's like Robert Kagan, and who's the wife of Victoria Nuland, who was one of her best buddies at the State Department, who's behind a lot of the problems with Ukraine, has piled up with her, has made fundraising dinners for her. William Crystal,
right,
has also
endorsed
called
her.
Everyone to vote for, endorsed her, vote for Hillary. There's about 30 now. Basically, nearly all the neocons that were behind the Iraq War have now backed Hillary.
So
that tells you something very interesting. It tells you something about Hillary Clinton, but it also tells you something about Donald Trump, and it tells you something about the neocons. So the neocons' sense of identity and their interests are not strongly colour-lined with the Republican Party.
Right.
So they don't view... Because I've believed, naively, that the neocons were deeply Republican. And why, you know, if their interests differed to the candidate, Donald Trump, for whatever reasons, they might not aggressively push him. That's very different to crossing the floor and, if you like, backing the enemy as far as the Republicans are concerned. So all along, the neocons were not really Republican. They were something else, and they had a different agenda.
You think that if she wins, she's going to continue the warmongering policies that have basically been going on for about the last 40 years. She's
unfortunately, I think she'll accelerate it. There'll be a moderately significant uptick compared to her under the Obama administration. But remember, this period from 2009-2012 of Hillary Clinton being Secretary of State in the Obama administration produced a lot of conflict. Hillary Clinton got out at the end, and so John Kerry had to deal with it. But if you look at the successes by John Kerry, diplomatic successes, at his term in office compared to Hillary Clinton's, there's a world of difference. Now, to be fair to her, you could say some of the reason for this is that Obama's trying to move into his legacy phase, and after having, you know, satisfied the, broadly speaking, the military-industrial complex in the United States and a bunch of other powerful actors, he's now moving into a position to shore up his historical reputation after he leaves office. So John Kerry might have been given a little more rein than Hillary Clinton was. But, yeah, there's significant diplomatic successes under John Kerry in terms of peacemaking, deal-making, reduction of tension. But Hillary Clinton's time in office saw the opposite.
Right. So you think going forward, it's going to be
continued,
even though she's in a weakened...
That's just analysis on that's just analysis on results in office. But there's a lot of other indicators, what she has said in her emails, the types of people that she chooses to associate, the types of people who endorse her, that her positions on legislation and on war, but her being the leading... her not only being the leading voice in the administration to bring about the bombing of Libya and the destruction of the Libyan state, but being towards the end of 2011 so proud of that effort that within inside the State Department she produced, or had her staff produce, a what we call a Libya brag sheet. It's all the and what they call a TikTok. It's the chronological description of how she was the central figure in bringing about the destruction of the Libyan state.
And I'm trying to think of, is there anything that she did that was good during her tenure as Secretary of State? I can't think of anything. What about Honduras?
I'm sure there must be something. It's you know, politicians sell themselves, and the State Department sells itself. So there's already an oversupply of an institution bringing out her good points. So, of course, investigative journalists concentrate on the negatives.
I've been...
none come to mind. I'm sure there must be some.
Well, I can't think of any. I've written articles about her. You know, she was running for Senate here in 2000, and now she pushed herself as this big progressive when it comes to civil rights, Black Lives Matter. You know, she lives just a mile away from two prisons, female prisons, Bedford Hills and Taconic prisons. She never once dropped by, not one time did she drop by to say hello to the prisoners, and they're 94% Black and Latino in both of those prisons, maximum security prisons, just a mile away. And so I get a lot of heat that I, by attacking Hillary, which I do here whenever I have a chance at this radio station, I get a lot of heat that I'm actually helping out Donald Trump by attacking Hillary Clinton. I mean, this is the Democratic Party's problem, that they chose a very weak candidate with a real sordid background. You are getting a lot of heat. You know, people are saying, well, Julian's basically going to help Donald Trump. Is there really a difference between these two?
Yes, there are differences between them.
In your mind?
There are significant differences between them as individuals. I think, as it speaks in both directions, The issue, I think, is more the Republican Party and how much of how, look, individual presidents, once they are in office and are established, don't really do much. Most of their time, they are just taking the briefing sheets that are given to them, reading them to teleprompters, the briefing sheets that they're given for meetings, or then sometimes they are given two or three alternatives by the secretaries and members of cabinet and asked to choose between them. So, you know, it's not like these the alternatives that are presented to them are diametrically opposed. So that they're alternatives plucked from a very narrow pond. And where are they produced from? Well, they're produced from the major U.S. corporations and their ability to inject proposals to go into governmental decision-making and lobby for particular ones to be selected, and from the bureaucracies, the CIA, Department of Homeland Security, Army, Pentagon, Veterans Affairs, etc. So there's just one point where the candidate really does make a difference, and that is in the appointment phase. So there's about 3,500 positions that are appointed in the few months of the government coming into office. And so Hillary Clinton will select certain cronies, people she owes favor, etc., and those people will be appointed to various positions, and they in turn will recommend to her other appointments. And similarly, with Donald Trump, he will be appointing a whole bunch of people that come out of, you know, his real estate network, people he's met in the entertainment industry, new friends that he's made during this campaign. And where there are gaps in his own personal network of trust, he will be feeding from what the Republican Party offers him.
Do you think he's really trying to win, or do you think he's tanking it?
I think it's a very interesting question, whether it was a serious campaign in the beginning, whether, you know, there are allegations. I don't have any evidence. It's amusing to speculate whether Hillary Clinton and Bill Clinton, who allegedly spoke to him about whether he should run, given that they have a close association in the past, that Clinton's might have thought it would be helpful to have Donald Trump in there. I think it is clear now, given the amount of effort that he's putting into things, the amount of time that it's consuming, that was genuinely always intending to run as far as possible, or he has become trapped into it.
Right. Well, I'm not like a big conspiracy person, but I got to tell you, here it feels like watching this that he's part of the team, because he's about the only person that she could possibly beat with her record.
Yeah, you know? I mean, I think that's pretty true. Although amongst those 17 Republican candidates, there was a lot of chaff. There are also some
maybe
rather
Rand
poor characters. Poor candidates, not in terms of saying so much the very inflammatory, divisive things that Trump says that alienates whole groups of the population.
I mean, some of the people around him, Rudy Giuliani, this guy, yeah. Chris Christie, this sheriff from Arizona, this nutcase racist sheriff,
yeah.
Arpaio, it's very difficult to like him, you know. But there are other candidates. There's Gary Johnson and there's Jill Stein. Jill Stein called you a hero. What do you think about her campaign?
Well, I think she's clearly a brave woman, and the Greens are brave this election by, you know, sticking up for WikiLeaks and its right to publish and its imprisoned sources and so on. That's, I mean, obviously, we hear that as something that is important. It's actually a really good signal that is possible in the U.S. political debate. I mean, of course, course, whether it's possible for someone like Jill Stein to be elected is another matter.
Well, it's almost impossible for her to be elected.
But she has said these things, and there is some reportage. It's not being smashed in everyone's face like the Trump and Clinton campaign coverage, but there is a little bit.
One of Trump's supporters, Roger Stone, who I know. I actually know Roger Stone. He was on this show, go figure, a couple of weeks back. But he bandied your name. But then, of course, he backtracked and said he didn't know. He didn't have any communication with you. But, he does toss things around.
Roger Stone is a rather canny spin master.
Yes.
And we have not had any communication with him whatsoever.
Yes.
I do imagine his position, he wants to... I mean, he has said nice things about us. I think he said that I was a hero, so, okay, that's nice. We appreciate that kind of thing. So I'm not minded to criticize him too much for doing something that any kind of political operative would do, which is basically to try and get in on get in on our publications in some way by suggesting that he had something to do with it. But actually, no, it's all our hard work and the hard work of our sources.
Right, and you are doing
Republicans have not helped at all. If they want to donate money, like anyone else,
yes, that's
they
a
can
thing.
Do that. We'd welcome that.
Well, before
if they want to give us accurate documents, which we will check, of course, on the Clinton campaign, we'd welcome that. And similarly, we'd welcome it from the Clintons or Stein or whoever.
Maybe you'll get some money from the CGI, the Clinton Global Initiative. Have you?
Yeah, I doubt it.
Now, let me say, but while we're there, people who want to, we're talking to Julian Assange at WikiLeaks and the Ecuadorian Embassy in London. It's 11 o'clock there, is it? 10 o'clock, 10:30?
It's very hot. It's the hottest August in London ever.
It's the hottest. What do we have, Celsius? 33?
And there's 33? No air conditioning in the embassy.
You have no air conditioning? I got to tell you, you look great. I see you on television with Jake Tapper the other day. How do you maintain your energy and your health? I mean, you work out of the embassy?
Well, I have an exercise regime. You have to do these types of things, but I am in love with understanding the world and sharing that understanding with other people. It's a bit hard to describe how much I am in love with that. And have been for many years. And then at the same time, when you're in a conflict, when people are trying to, malign your work or engaging banking blockades or as they are doing, attempting to send me and other people to prison, it's very stimulating. And so you feel energetic under these circumstances. I mean, when you've been attacked.
I'm sure you do. I'm sure it must be an impossible situation day in and day out, but you've done an incredible job. You're, just a remarkable example of strength and hope. And I know you're taking a huge sacrifice when you got into this business. You knew it was possible that something like this would happen eventually. Am I right?
Sure. I actually expected it. Not exactly this, but something close to this. A couple of years earlier, actually, I thought it would happen.
Well, here I just saw the UN has formally found, I think it was actually in February, that you were unlawfully detained by Sweden and the UK. Can you expand on that?
Yes, on February 5, the United Nations formally found that I am being illegally detained by Sweden and the UK and must be immediately released and compensated. So that's obviously a hugely significant win for us. The UK is and Sweden so far have actively defied that ruling. They have paid some diplomatic consequences for it. Hopefully those consequences will increase over time. We have various legal mechanisms that we've tried to put in place, that we are putting in place to try and enforce those decisions. And you can go to justiceforassange.com
right.
with a numeral 4 in the middle, justiceforassange.com,
JusticeForAssange.com.
They can go see the UN.
I see it right here. So I'm there right now. So people can go there. How do people help out with the legal bills? Is there a...
If you go to JusticeForAssange.com, there's a donate thing on the right-hand side, and that goes to our general staff defense fund, which to protect me and to protect the rest of our staff.
And so that's one way.
It is quite expensive.
I know it is.
We have 154 lawyers that are either on our legal team as staff or have advised, the majority advised at some stage during those last few years. All of them are working either pro bono or at highly reduced rates or some just for costs. Mm-hmm. But nonetheless, that's a big team.
The big blow was the loss of Michael Ratner. I know that was a huge blow.
Enormous blow for us in the United States. He was our chief counsel. It was a blow to a number of other groups who were using him. But the primary case he was spending his time on the last couple of years were our various legal cases.
He worked very hard on that case, and I know people associated with him who still are. So that's one way people can donate. They go to JusticeForAssange.com. And is there any other way people can?
Yes, they can go to WikiLeaks.org, and you'll see a donate thing there. We're tax deductible in the United States and also in Europe. I was just joking with one of my lawyers who was visiting yesterday that this is absurd, like Biden calling me a high-tech terrorist and all these calls out for my assassination. And like, yes, high-tech terrorist, you know, assassinate him illegally, shoot the son of a bitch, which is what Bob Beckel, this Democratic...
Bob Beckel said that?
On sex. Bob Beckel said he ought to be assassinated. Sorry, can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead. Tell me about Beckel. Yes, I'm sorry.
Yeah, so Bob Beckel
said... It's a windbag.
Democratic strategist. I'm not... he should be assassinated. Assange should be assassinated. And I'm not for the death penalty. So if I'm not for the death penalty, there's only one way to do it, illegally shoot the son of a bitch.
That's what Bob Beckel said.
That's Bob Beckel.
Yeah, I'm embarrassed.
That's what Bob Beckel said. So anyway, we joke like, yeah, WikiLeaks, a high-tech terrorist publishing organization that is tax deductible in the United States and Europe.
Well, it's my favorite.
Somehow it doesn't work, right? It doesn't. You can't have tax deductible in the United States and Europe and somehow be...
You're on his terror list. You're basically on the hit list by Bob Beckel. Look, I know the guy. I worked at a comedy club in the upper. I forgot who it was for, but he was in the audience. And he came up to me completely whacked out on like 9 shots of tequila, and he gave me a beat. He said, "You were great." And that was the only time I ever had any association with Bob Beckel. Look, I can't stand CNN. Jake Tapper, I thought, was rude to you. I know that Megyn Kelly, you'll be on today with Megyn Kelly on Fox. You were on last night. Part two is tonight. Megyn Kelly. And how did that go?
Well, Tapper, I didn't think was so rude. Tapper, I didn't think was so rude, actually. I thought he was relatively...
Well, I'm prejudiced.
Polite. But I say relatively. You have to understand that these guys are in the mainstream media. And so... You know, just in order to justify how they behave, they have to make certain nasty questions. But you can often read whether they're enthusiastically into the attack or whether they feel they just have to go through some of the motions, because that's what's expected of them. So for Jake Tapper and for the Fox woman, Megyn Kelly, they were not, you know, their heart was not in the attack. I'll tell you whose heart was in it. Chuck Todd.
Oh, the worst. Chuck Todd. I call him Chuck Fraud. Chuck Fraud is the worst. Of course, he doesn't like you because of that leak and the DNC.
Well, we revealed in DNC emails that he was being called up by Debbie Wasserman Schultz and her crew, and like, you know, what the hell's going on? They're speaking about Sanders in a particular way, and, you know, shut that down.
Well, thank God she's gone, and I wish I would make the trade. I wish he were gone and Wasserman Schultz was still there. I'd prefer to get rid of him because he's a horror show at MSNBC, at NBC, and he's not really a journalist. Jeremy Scahill called him out on the Mars show like 4 or 5 years ago. The guy freaked out. Chuck Todd.
Well, he's close to the Clintons, and you see how Meet the Press works.
Supported by Boeing. Boeing underwrites that show.
It's a Sunday show, so they sort of set up what the White House wants the discussion to be in the first part of the week.
I think it's all of MSNBC. I think that they should just
most
move.
Of it, yes.
They should just move right into the White House.
Right. I mean, it's an interesting question whether MSNBC is effectively, socially, and in terms of its structure and proprietors and so on, a White House outfit, or whether it is a center of power of the Democratic Party outfit. I think that's quite an interesting question. I'm not sure what the answer is.
Have you been interviewed by Chris Hayes?
I think I might have been once years ago, but he's been, on Twitter at least, he's been slandering us constantly.
He's been slandering you. He's amazing. You know, it was, and I thought the guy did a pretty good job, Keith Olbermann. Keith Olbermann was okay. They got rid of him, you know, because he was too far out there. And they bring in Rachel Maddow, and they bring in Chris Hayes, and they both become attack dogs for the administration.
Yeah, he has Chris Hayes. There's also a middle-aged black woman. I can't recall her name.
Joy Reid?
Joy Reid, right. Yeah, and she has been particularly bad.
Well, it's we call MSNBC. They, you know, if you ever watch them around the clock, you will see half of the programming there is a show called Lockup. Lockup. It's all about this sick, disgusting, rancid, voyeuristic display of prisoners in one of our.
Is it? I haven't seen that.
Yeah, Lockup. And I asked one of the guys, Howard Fineman, at the New Hampshire primary, I was there, and I asked Fineman, I said, how on earth could you be on a show that's underwritten? Because he said, well, it's cheap, it doesn't cost much money, and with the money that they make, it helps pay for Chris Hayes and Rachel Maddow. That's what he said. That was the answer. You got to check out Lockup. On MSNBC, just look it up online. Lockup, it's their flagship show because everything else loses money. Remember, she does not have a big audience. 300,000 people watch MSNBC.
Maddow,
330 million Americans don't watch her. So we shouldn't take them too seriously.
I think they're not really using it to influence. They're using it to influence influencers, right? I mean, that's the point, to help. Help get out stories in particular angles, like with Chuck Todd, to kind of set the narrative drum for the week, or to present a defense.
Well, I'm sorry to see that.
To present an attack that will then be picked up and spread. Because, I mean, if you look at the numbers are not what seems to me on the back of the envelope analysis, the numbers are not enough to justify the payment.
Absolutely. It really is not. The numbers are very low. And CNN is okay. How has Wolf Blitzer treated you? Have you been on with Wolf Blitzer?
I think I might have. I don't think so, actually. He definitely has covered our material. I recall distinctly when we released Collateral Murder, which was about a 30-minute tape of Apache gun camera footage, the first time such footage in high resolution was released, showing an Apache helicopter mowing down 18 people in the suburb New Baghdad in Baghdad, including two Reuters journalists. And Wolf Blitzer, he's even though this was a journalistic effort by us, which in some sense was made for TV because there was very dramatic visual images. He made sure to spin it and only take, you know, one segment, which wasn't as bad as the majority segment. But I mean, you know, he's kind of, if you look at Wolf Blitzer's connections to Clinton and the sort of things that he angles he tries to push. I mean, it's not a surprise thing. I think most people in the media industry understand that Wolf Blitzer is quite a partisan figure.
Takes him a long time to say anything. Ever noticed that about Wolf Blitzer? Takes him about 2 weeks to, you know, get out a one sentence question. Wolf Blitzer take a lot of time. He could do 1 2-hour show with one sentence. Wolf Blitzer, but and
yeah, I mean, it's a shitty job. So I mean,
we're gonna have to. It's okay. We don't care. It's all right. We're talking with Julian Assange, the most wanted person by Bob Beckel. Bob Beckel, what a great guy with the suspenders. What a joke he is. And, you know, so look.
He's not the only one. I mean, there's been quite a lot of those.
You think Bill Clinton's happy?
Bill O'Reilly, too.
What about O'Reilly?
O'Reilly said I should be assassinated by a drone. And then Mike Grunwald at Time magazine, not so long ago, actually, said he couldn't wait to write the defense of the Obama administration for killing me with a drone.
Wow.
He's a kind of Obama hagiographer. Well, he's now moved to Politico.
It's
not just me. They've also gone for other staff, me as an organization, and of course some of our sources they've said should be executed. It's, you know, what I find a bit disturbing, you think journalists, whatever their associations are, everyone has associations and friends that they make on the job or whoever they interview, you think that at their core, their number one self-interest is being able to practice journalism.
Right. Yeah?
So you think, okay, maybe they're a bit compromised around the edges, but in the end, they need an audience to listen to them, and they have to be able to say things. So you think that would be their core interest. Unfortunately, it's not true. Actually, they defer to these other interests. They defer what you would assume were their core interests, the ability of journalists to speak freely, to not encourage assassination campaigns against publishers and so on. They easily sweep that aside in order to pander to the interests in the Democratic establishment or Republican establishment or in the arms complex, in banking establishments, etc.
I think of you, in this country, going back to the 1840s, Elijah Lovejoy. You know who Elijah Lovejoy was, the abolitionist?
No, I don't.
Well, you should look him up, because that was you in 1840. He was telling the truth way back, 1840. Elijah Lovejoy, he was in Missouri, which was part of the Missouri Compromise. He was anti-slavery, and ruffians came in, and they shut him down. He set up shop again, and they said, you know, enough of this noise, and they killed him, threw him in the Missouri River, and destroyed his printing press. And his brother went on, Owen Lovejoy, to be one of the leaders in the House of Representatives that supported Abe Lincoln. But Elijah Lovejoy, that's you. You're under siege there, Julian Assange. You're a courageous man, and I hope that we can get you back on this show. You have an open invitation to be on this show and other shows. We here at WBAI are huge fans of Julian Assange. I can tell you that. And we got you back here, I can tell you.
Okay, great. I'll be very happy to be back on.
Once again, just give people want to donate, they go to Julian, Justice for Julian.
JusticeForAssange.com.
Or they can go to WikiLeaks.
Or they can go to WikiLeaks and that goes to the publisher.
I got to tell you something. I could have you on for 4 or 5 hours. I really appreciate you being on this show. And we'll be in touch. And anytime, Julian Assange, folks, the one and only, the great, 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 great. There we go. That's him. We're going to play this.
Great.
We're going to play this out for you. Julian, you can hear this. We're going to play this out for you. This is Johnny Cash.
No, I won't back down. Can stand me.